This is a little extra video since I've just put this Gazelle on the road after a bit of a refurbishment. I want to tell you about what I think is one of the most marvellous innovations that there's ever been in bicycle brakes, at least bicycle brakes for practical everyday use, specifically city riding. So we're not talking about super powerful hydraulics here, we're not talking about discs, any modern innovations. This is an innovation which Gazelle came up with and had on their models for many years, until finally they had to go with the flow and fit cable brakes on everything. This bike is a 1997, which is, I believe, the last year that rod brakes were fitted to a Gazelle, possibly to any production bike. I don't know, I'd have to look up Pashley to make sure. However, I digress. This is the Gazelle interlinked rod and drum brake system. So we have drum brakes. The front is Gazelle's own, but it's a Stirling Archer copy. You notice it's on the right hand side. I wondered why Gazelle fitted theirs on the right hand side while Stirling Archer, sorry about the fingers, fitted them to the left hand side. I think it's so that they can use one back plate for both, because of the way that the back plate comes out of the bottom of there, it would line it up with the chainstay in a rear brake situation. I don't know, maybe they could just use Stirling Archer rear back plates in that case. There may be some other reason known to Gazelle why they made their own front and the rear. I'll come round. The rear is a Stirling Archer. Excuse the horrible wheel nut that is being changed. The bike was literally put on the road hours ago. So now, what's so special about this braking system? Let's turn the bike at an angle so we can see better. It looks like a normal rod brake system. You know, the type that's really useless in the wet. And it has a stirrup coming down here that judders underneath the wheel rim and produces more noise than stopping. All of that nastiness. However, that's not the fault of rods as an operation system. It's the fault of the stirrups and the way that that was set up. But that was a particularly English disease. This is how the Dutch did it, or at least it's how Gazelle did it. Now, I'll start off by showing you what happens when you pull one of these levers. Watch that lever there as I pull this lever here. Okay, they're both linked. So from the rods, you see that, from the levers, you see that this is the front rod going down to the front wheel down there. This is the rear rod going by the normal method down to the rear wheel. So they're interlinked, yeah, okay, they're interconnected. They're connected inside that piece of black plastic in the middle. I'm not going to go into it because there's springs and things. And I didn't pay much more attention to that other than, oh, they're interlinked, how clever. Until I looked a bit closer. Now, I am acquainted with old Moto Guzzi and BMW motorcycles, both of which experimented reasonably successfully with interlinked brakes. And their system was well designed, modulating which brake came on first and the relative pressure between the two. I didn't think that such a simple system of this would do the same. But let's see what's going on here. Bearing in mind, this is the rear, this is the front, and this is the lever that pulls them. So you've got a lever with one rod further away than the other. By the laws of physics and geometry, therefore, the rear rod is being pulled approximately twice as far, if not a little more than twice as far, as the front rod. What that means is, if you've got your brakes set balanced, that rear brake, this one here, is going to engage slightly before the front brake. Now, in a situation where you're riding in wet conditions, that's what you want. You want your ideal braking is the rear brake coming on slightly before the front to stop a front wheel skid, and then the rear brake remains on the whole time. You can't release it until you've released the front brake. Brilliant for frosty mornings and wet cobbles and leaves and that sort of thing, just what you want. So far so interesting. Now, carrying the principle one stage further, this is being pulled far, twice as far as this, so it comes on first. However, when you pull an object from a longer lever, you're getting more movement but correspondingly less force. So the force is going to be greater on here. Same amount of energy pulling it half the way, it's going to produce twice the force, I think, unless it's some different formula. So we pull the lever, rear brake engages, front brake engages slightly after rear brake, but front brake is exerting around twice the force of the rear brake. So you've got, when you're riding the bicycle, bear in mind you can use one hand, pull the lever, the sequence is rear brake comes on, then front brake comes on twice as hard as rear brake. Keep pulling and both brakes increase in force. That is absolutely brilliant, perfect braking for inclement conditions. The British probably would have called this an all-weather bicycle. To the Dutch, it's just a bicycle. But it's not something I've seen elsewhere on bicycles. I presume it's a patent by Gazelle. It's a shame it's not one of those patents that was allowed to be repeated elsewhere. Right, let's go and demonstrate it. Slippery wood. That is slippery, that. That was a stone or stick or something whacking the chain case. Puddle, slippery wood. This is really slippery. And a perfectly controlled stop on what really is quite slippery wood. And you saw a couple of muddy stops there as well. I'm looking forward to frosty mornings and trying this out on the frost. A couple of years ago, in January, I came off my Rally Superb in frost and did my right knee in to an extent that it hasn't fully recovered. So, the answer is, I should have been riding a Gazelle. Okay, so that's the Gazelle interlinked braking system. You'll find them on any Gazelle from, I'm not sure when they came in, probably 60s I think onwards, which has rod brakes up until the late 90s when they phased them out. If it's got this little plastic housing between the rods, it's probably got the interlinked brakes. If you're looking at the bike face to face with a view to getting one, just tweak the lever. If it's got the two levers, it's got the clever braking system. So this is was going to be one of my winter hacks. I have a couple of Dutch bikes as winter hacks. I've put one away and I'm giving the other one to a friend whom I owe a Dutch bike. And this one is going to be ridden for the rest of the winter. So I will bring updates on how it fares and how these brakes are in action. Okay, thanks for watching. Keep subscribed if you're not already for more interesting bicycle geekery and nonsense. And we'll see you soon.